Hi guys, Nick Jennison from Guitar Interactive Magazine. It is now 2024. We are at the Yamaha booth with Brandon, who's going to show us around some really exciting new guitars. Specifically, we're going to begin with some new Pacificas. Now, we were chatting about this off camera. For any of you guys out there who may associate Pacifica with great affordable entry-level guitar, that is true, but the origins of the Pacifica are in high-end custom shop guitars, which this is harkening back to. And forgive me if I'm wrong, but the Pacifica name, it refers to the collaboration between the West Coast of America, Japanese luthiers. We'll talk all about this, but I'm gonna let Brandon take the lead on this, because these are really exciting. It's the first time I've met them. Do you wanna tell us about these really cool new guitars?
Yes, you hit the nail on the head. The original Pacificas actually came out in 1990. And those guitars were a collaboration between our custom shop in Los Angeles and our headquarters in Hamamatsu, Japan. And those guitars were really made for Los Angeles session players of the time. They were high-end instruments. And over the years, the model became beloved at the entry to mid-level. So those guitars are still available, but these new models are really harkening back to that. We once again collaborated between our Los Angeles custom shop and Hamamatsu, Japan. The aesthetic of the guitar is also harkening back to that. All of the color choices are based around Japanese city pop, which was actually a genre of music popular in Japan in the late 80s that was influenced by West Coast Los Angeles music. Even down to the aesthetic, we're harkening back.
Nice.
What you're looking at here is we've got the Pacifica Professional and the Standard Plus. We'll start with the Professional here.
Sure.
So I'll do a quick rundown. There's a lot of new specs in these guitars. A lot of R&D went into them. Years of R&D, in fact. And starting at the headstock here, both models are gonna get Goto locking tuners. You've got a brand new Slim C neck profile with satin finishes. Both guitars have stainless steel frets.
Nice.
We've got a Graftech nut with a bit of a wider 42 millimeter width. So more comfortable for most modern players.
Yeah.
We've got some new inlays there. The truss rod adjustment has been moved from the top of the headstock to the end of the headstock, or the end of the neck rather. Super easy adjustment there. Also adds a little more mass to the headstock, which, as we all know, the more mass at this point, the better.
Yeah, especially if you're traveling, because,
100%. So that's the decision there. Really easy adjustment. The pickups, we are very excited about. This is an industry first, actually. We spent about 4 years collaborating with Rupert Neve Designs develop these pickups. So Rupert Neve Designs are titans of the professional audio industry. With their decades of experience in both high-end audio and in transformer manufacturing, which actually shares a lot of similarities with guitar pickups, when you start thinking about coils and winding.
Yeah, it's a coil,
Exactly. Sure. They were the perfect people to partner with, and we're really happy with how these came out. The goal of the pickups was balance, clarity, and versatility. And we feel like we've really achieved all three of those.
Nice.
On an HSS guitar, there's often some volume discrepancy switching between.
Yeah.
Not an issue on this guitar. The bridge pickup is balanced with the rest of the pickups. They have an extremely wide sound. There's a lot of bass and an airy, bright, shiny treble, which is often hard to achieve both in a pickup.
Yeah, HSS is one of the hardest configurations to get right.
Yeah.
You know, you start messing with things like inline capacitors and all that. But if you get it right at the pickup, you know, that's probably the best way to do it.
Yeah.
So really excited to plug these in. Tell us a little bit more.
Yeah, when you do get it right, the versatility is unmatched. I mean, especially since we have a coil split on that bridge humbucker, there's just so many tonal options, master volume, master tone. This is also a Goto 2-point tremolo. Super smooth, great return to pitch, and a great travel as well. You can do anything from a light sort of Bigsby-style shimmer to a dive bomb. Returns to pitch without an issue. And of course, some fresh new colors, new pickguard design, matching our Revstar guitars with that pickguard.
On
the back, a newly contoured neck heel. Super comfortable, your hand just fades right into it.
Great.
We've got a fresh belly cut. We've got a newly designed arm bevel as well. And under all the paint, I'll show you this in a minute, there is some acoustic design chambering going on. Some really interesting stuff. Overall, we're thrilled with these guitars. The Professional is a compound fingerboard radius, 10 to 14 inches.
Nice.
And the Standard Plus is a set 13.8 inch radius.
Nice.
The Professional also undergoes our IRA treatment, which is initial response acceleration. Sort of getting the whole thing gelled together.
Yeah, yeah.
So
we're shaking the wood loose before it
goes
on. Yeah. Now this is something we talk about quite a lot in the magazine. Is guitars tend to get better as they age, and a lot of folks, it's very fashionable at the moment to try and distill the sound of an electric guitar down to just the electronic components, we know that's not the whole picture. And, you know, even on a solid body electric guitar, as the guitar gets played and played and played, it gets looser, it gets nicer, and you guys are just speeding that process up for us.
Yeah. So, well, and the primary thing too is that you could theoretically take the same pickup and put it on a block of wood or something and get the general sound, but when you have increased resonance, the feel is better on the player. The sustain tends to be better, especially when you have an amp in the room and you're interacting, the guitar is resonating. Makes a really noticeable difference.
Yeah, 100%. So, do you know the retail price on these?
Yeah, so a US street price is $21.99 on professional, $13.49 on standard plus.
Nice, so still very affordable for such a pro level instrument.
Yeah, for something that's, you know, really gonna give you your one-stop shop for any sound, any genre, any gig or recording session, it's definitely a solid value. And a Pacifica Professional is made in Japan. Right. And Standard Plus is made in Indonesia.
Okay, so here's one we didn't make earlier. This is what goes into the Pacifica. You were telling us about some of the interesting acoustic design stuff that's going on here. Talk to us about this body.
So our engineers have a process called acoustic design. Essentially, they can 3D model the body of the guitar. They can test out different chambering patterns and different wood formations. And then they can simulate resonating the wood at different frequencies. That tells them where are their dead spots, where are their live spots, how is the guitar performing. What they found is that adding these slits under the pickguard area in this pattern reduces the stiffness of the body in this area, and adding a bar in the control cavity increases the stiffness in this area.
Interesting.
So we're playing a balancing act between the different ends of the guitar. And the result is that you end up with no dead spots and live spots, one big unit that resonates evenly all the way across.
Very exciting.
Yeah, this is found in the Standard Plus and the Professional models.
Through the magic of video editing, we find ourselves next to a wall of RevStars.
Yep.
Tell us what you guys have brought. Now, this is a model that is close to our heart. We took a look at some of the first RevStars that came out. Really great. One of our very good friends, Chris Buck, is a big champion of the RevStar guitar. We love him. We want to know what's new for 2024. Do you want to tell us about them?
Yeah, so what we've got here is a wall of RevStar goodness. We have three tiers to the RevStars right now. There's Professional, there's Standard, and there's Element. So really something for everybody at every price range. We've got two different versions. We have a double P90 version, and we have a double humbucker version. These guitars actually share a lot of the acoustic design that we just saw in Pacifica.
Sure.
So a lot of that body chambering is going on in there for enhanced resonance. Additionally, in these guitars, we have carbon reinforcement. So there's some carbon reinforcement in the body as well as in the neck. It's gonna stop that neck from shifting over time.
Yeah.
It's gonna keep the body stiff in the right places while the chambering keeps it loose in the right places.
Interesting.
With the ultimate goal of getting the whole body to resonate as one unit instead of having like dead spots and live spots. Really a resonant instrument. You can get stop tail varieties, trapeze tail pieces, a variety of colors, left-handed options.
Nice.
The RevStars have really matured into a line that has something for everybody. And as you mentioned, our friend Chris Buck,
he's
a champion of these guitars.
100%.
You know, he really pulls out the potential.
Now, we are really excited to see when the Chris Buck signature model is going to drop. We've seen him playing it. Is that something we can expect to see in retail at any time?
At this time, we don't have a Chris Buck model to show this year.
If you have the ear of somebody, we'd like to see it. But listen, so that's really, really great. So the carbon you mentioned, is that just on the RevStar Professional, or is that across the whole range?
It is not across the entire range. The Professional is definitely the champion of the range when it comes to all of the specs.
Interesting. Very, very cool. And of course, new finishes for 2024. We love this. This is really, really great.
Yeah.
Beautiful. So something for everyone. have some acoustics over this way. Should we make our way across?
Through the magic of editing, I say we do.
So we now find ourselves in acoustic land. We're looking at a guitar that we saw last year at April's NAMM show in 2023. This is the FG9. Now, we do have a video on this guitar already, but we wanted to touch on it and recap it in case any of you guys missed it. Do you want to talk to us about what's going on with this really beautiful instrument?
Absolutely. We are really proud of these guitars. This is the FG9R. It's got beautiful rosewood back and sides. We have an FG9M variety as well with mahogany back and sides. And basically what's going on with these, this is the upper echelon, this is the premier FG model that we have in our lineup. We're looking at Adirondack tops. It's a very stiff wood that is very loud. It projects and has very high headroom. So you can dig into these things, they don't start to compress in on themselves, and they resonate and they project. Something cool about the top as well, it's actually a tapered top. So the center of the top is a little bit thicker than the outside rim of the top. That's to keep it structurally sound in the center and to keep it resonating freely on the outside rims.
Interesting.
We've got, you know, Adirondack bracing on the inside as well, which is scalloped. We went through an extremely extensive R&D process with these. We have an acoustic luthier at our Los Angeles custom shop. And the process is that he would build a handmade acoustic guitar, send it to Japan for detailed analysis, and then they would respond and say, okay, tweak this one spec. Then he would build another handmade acoustic guitar.
Oh, wow.
He did that 51 times.
Oh, dude. And that's not a quick process. Acoustic guitars take a long time to build.
Absolutely.
Glue needs to dry and lacquers in the air.
And it's got to go back and forth. And so this was years of development, but you know, that's what we got to do to come up with the best possible guitar.
But you've got to admire that commitment, man. And I did want to pick up on the tape at top, because that is something very interesting. I know obviously some other notable acoustic guitar brands have tried to achieve the same effect with bracing patterns, where maybe the top is a little stiffer in the center for projection, and then it's a little looser for volume and all that sort of thing around here in sustain. Sustain in the center, volume and projection with the loose braceness. It seems, I don't know why nobody's thought just to tape at the top before. That is a very clever move.
And when you do start doing something like that, and you start thinking about how it interacts with the bracing, suddenly now there's new bracing patterns that are opened up. There's of new course. Options for how deep you can scallop. There's, and all of that is what goes into the R&D process. That's why we made Andrew Enns build 51 guitars. it was a job well done.
It was worth it, let me tell you. So I had the luxury of playing this guitar last year. If you do get the chance to check one out, it's really worth your time. Really superb guitars. And this is going to sound like a strange thing to say, because this is a very expensive guitar. It's very high end. But it's actually a little bit of a bargain compared to some of the other similarly high-end acoustics that we're seeing at the show this year and that we saw last year. Because, correct me if I'm wrong, what's the street price on one of these?
So the mahogany is $39.99, street price US, and it's only $100 more for the rosewood.
Rosewood.
$40.99.
Right.
When you start looking at boutique guitars, they can easily get up $8,000-$9,000 in that range.
And the rest.
These are being hand-built by a very small team of our top luthiers in Japan. The craftsmanship, the quality control is top-notch. It's the best Yamaha has to offer. And when you look at it through that lens, it really is a bang for the buck.
Sure, no kidding. Which seems strange to say about such a high-end guitar, but it is a bit of a bargain.
Yeah.
So hey, there you go. I mean, if you got that kind of money to throw around, you could do a lot worse than one of these, let me tell you.
Yeah.
So listen, Brandon, thank you so much. It's been a pleasure. This has been a look at Yamaha guitars, but of course, let's not forget that under the Yamaha umbrella, we also have Line 6.
Yeah.
So let's go take a look at some of the exciting stuff that we have there. And we're going to hand off to your colleague, Nick.
Yeah, we'll introduce you to my good friend, Nick.
Excellent. Let's make it happen.
Line 6.
When we return, Nick will be on camera. Not me, the other Nick. But yeah, let's go check out some Line 6 stuff. All right, so we find ourselves at the Line 6 portion of the Yamaha booth with my friend Nick. Nick's with Featherfly together and all that stuff. We've said all of the puns off camera.
Yep.
I think that was the last one. But Nick,
I think so.
It is great to see you. Thank you so much for taking the time to show us around the new hot thing, which everybody's been very excited about. This has been the talk of so many groups on the internet. Everybody wants to know what's going on with the HX1.
Of
so
course.
Do you want to tell us about this, how it came to be, what we're looking at, who might get a kick out of it, how people are going to use it on the pedal boards?
Give
us the whole story.
Oh, you got it. So this is HX1. It features over 250 effects from Helix. Just the effects. So no amp modeling, none of that. It's one effect at a time. And so when you think of users with a small pedal board or those with a big pedal board, but they just need to fill that one space, right? And this could be your Swiss Army knife, or it could be any effect that you want. Again, 250 effects drawn from Helix. You know, you can't go wrong with that. So what we have here is let's switch this over. So pretty much I could have my bypass, I could hit both foot switches at the same time and select one of 128 presets. Nice. So in one sitting, I could just go, you know, have my song, have the effects that I want. And then as I go down the list, it's automatically loading that sound for you. But what's really cool is once I select that preset, I could do my tap tempo, so now I'm in time with the band. But what's really exciting, again, I said those with a small pedal board, right? So if I don't have room for an expression pedal, what's really special about HX1 is that if I push the foot switch for 2 seconds, I enable flux mode. And what we get with flux mode is a way where I could ramp from minimum to maximum parameters at a specific time that I set. So for example, this optical trim, as we see, we'll notice on the screen that it's a kind of a slow ramp up and then a slow ramp down. And I can adjust how fast the ramp goes up down. So with the on time, I could choose milliseconds or I could choose note subdivision. But what's also really exciting is not just note subdivision, but I can choose beats too. So 8 beats, that's 2 bars. So if I want a low distortion when the song starts, I just hit this button and I hit that chord and then this distortion slowly rises up.
That's very cool. I like that.
So you can go in, choose your on time. You could also choose the on or off curve. So if you want it to be kind of a, we'll let it reset here. If I want it to be kind of like a slow ramp and then it ramps up quick, you can do so. So you have that control. So again, one effect at a time, you could plug it into the front of your amp, or by having stereo ins and outs, I could run it in 4-cable method. And what that means is I could have my reverbs and delays in my effects loop and my distortions, my compressors in front of the amp.
Fantastic.
And it automatically knows what those effects are.
That's great. That's really, really exciting. So I guess another application for this, something folks are quite excited about is, there is a kind of a culture of folks with Helix, kind of maxing out the processing power.
Oh, of course.
This might be a great way to maybe offload some of the more processor heavy effects,
exactly.
Like the poly effects.
Of course, of course.
Very cool. And of course, you know, for me, so I have a largely analog ecosystem. I have another modeler that I use, but it doesn't have quite the same like library of effects. The fuzzes aren't great, the vibe isn't great. Helix is a really great univibe. The analog drives are really, really on point. So this is a great way of getting some of that Helix flavor into another ecosystem.
Exactly.
If that's something
exactly.
that you're interested in.
Exactly.
Good. Very, very cool.
You know, if it's just like a DSP expansion for maybe another modeler you're using, like you said, or for our traditional amp users that still, you know, they're okay with modeling when it comes to their effects, but they love their amps, right?
Yeah.
That's what our HX effects or HX1 is perfect for.
Killer. Well, look. Listen, Nick, thank you so much for taking the time
of
to
course.
Show us this.
Always.
We
always.
Are going to hopefully grab one of these in our London studio. We'll put it under the microscope. You know what we do. We'll do the full detailed review. If that's something you guys are interested in hearing, if this guy's playing is something you're interested in hearing too, let us know in the comments down below. Also, while you're there, hit the buttons. You know what to do. You know where they are. Send this to your guitar playing friends, especially if they're fans of Yamaha guitars, Line 6 effects. It is NAMM 2024. It's about to get loud. We'll say goodbye. Our coverage continues. See you next time.